Let's stand together for the reading of the Word of God. Romans chapter 11, verse 33. Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been His counselor? I want to speak to you this morning on the depth of God's knowledge. Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Father, thank you this morning for the Word of God. Thank you this morning for the gospel of Jesus Christ, for the divine revelation given to us in Scripture of God. We pray that you'd give us the grace and the anointing that we need this morning to clarify truth. Lord, don't let us obscure truth. Help us, Jesus, to make known clearly the revelation of God in Scripture. Lord, I pray that you'd help us to present this morning an accurate description of God from His Word. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us to focus our minds upon you. Oh, God, our minds are so finite, and you're an infinite God. But I pray that you'd help us to focus on the Lord today and realize the greatness of God and give ourselves to you without reserve. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. The depth of God's knowledge. I mentioned to you last Sunday that the question in most minds is not, does God exist? Most everybody believes there is a God. Not many atheists in the world in comparison to the number of people in the world. But the problem is, what kind of God does exist? And last Sunday I told you that God is a holy God. And that is what distinguishes Him, makes Him worthy of our worship, is that God is a holy God. And He said, since I am a holy God, I want you to be a holy people. Be ye holy, for I am holy. Today I want us to see that God is all-knowing. I believe that God knows all things. Now, you know, it's hard for us to get a grasp of a mind like the mind of God that knows all things. The Bible says in Psalms 147 and verse 5, great is our Lord and of great power. His understanding is infinite. That is, it has no limit. There's no limit to the knowledge of God. God's understanding is infinite. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 20, for if our heart condemn us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. God knoweth all things. And I don't know that I can do justice. I know that I can't do justice to the subject I've got this morning, but I sure hope that I can help you to understand God a little better than maybe what you do right now. And talking about this God who knows all things. First of all, I want you to understand that God has a mind. He thinks. He knows. He lives. He is personal. That is, He possesses personality. He's not like a rock or a tree, or some inanimate object in the universe. God is a personal being. God has a mind. He is not ignorant. He's not dull in His understanding. He's not oblivious to what's going on in the universe. He is self-conscious, and He is creation-conscious, so that He not only knows about Himself, but He knows about everything that He has made. So that God is both self-conscious and creation-conscious. All that exists anywhere, get this, all that exists anywhere is the Creator and His creation. That's all that exists, is the Creator and His creation. And God has a mind in which He is aware of His own existence, and He is conscious of what He has made. So God is a God, a personal God. He has a mind. And in this mind of God, God has all knowledge, so that God cannot learn anything new. Now, understand that. You and I learn something new every day. But God cannot learn anything new. The Bible tells us in my text this morning, who hath known the mind of the Lord? Who hath been His counselor? Who can instruct God? God cannot be instructed. God does not learn anything new. God already knows all things. The Bible said in Isaiah chapter 40, verses 13 and 14, who hath directed the Spirit of the Lord, or being His counselor hath taught Him? With whom took He counsel? Who instructed Him in the path of judgment, and taught Him knowledge, and showed to Him the way of understanding? Now get this. Nobody knows anything true that is not already in the mind of God. Did you get that? I said, nobody knows anything that is true that is not already in the mind of God. And man's knowledge of truth in any field is due to the grace of God, allowing us to discover what is already in the mind of God. God gives us an inquiring mind. That is natural to man, to have an inquiring mind. And in our search for the truth of the universe, in our search for the truth of what we see around us, really what we are discovering is what's already in the mind of God. If it's not true, then it didn't come from God. But if it is true, it was already in the mind of God. God shares with us what He already knows, so that if there are advances made in the medical field in which men discover truths about medicine in an effort to help man recover health and well-being, anything that's true in the medical field was already known by God. I'm telling you, He already knew it. And in the field of anthropology, the study of man, you know, they dig up these ancient civilizations. They try to figure out where we came from. They try to figure out, you know, the customs and culture and so forth of ancient civilizations. But everything that man learns in anthropology that is true, God already knew it. In geology, the study of the earth, people seek to understand the composition of the earth, its history, its origin, and God already knows all about it. Hallelujah. Praise God. In theology, you know, that's the study of God. In critical religious subjects like salvation and angels and the nature of Christ and everything that's true in theology, God already knew it. Hallelujah. We just discovered things that God already knew. The study of astronomy, you know, the study of the stars. My, if you ever take time just to go outside at night and look up in the heavens and view the stars in the heavens, the multitude of the stars, the heavenly bodies that dot the sky. And men seek to understand through studying the stars. They try to arrive at some conclusion of the origin of the universe, its age. They look at the Earth's neighborhood and they try to figure out how big is Earth's neighborhood. And you know, they have seen through this Hubble telescope, they've seen billions of light years into the universe. So that they, you know what a light year is? Anybody know what a light year is? Raise your hand, you know what a light year is. Okay, light year is how far light travels in 1 year. Okay, it travels 186,000 miles per second. It takes light, it's 93 million miles to the sun. It takes light a little over 8 minutes to get from the sun to here. Is that right? Somebody correct me now if I'm wrong. Some of you college students, you know more than I do about it. So, am I wrong? Correct me now if I'm wrong. But I believe it's a little over 8 minutes that it takes the light from the sun to get to the earth. And that light How far that light travels in 1 year is a light year. And they have seen billions of light years into this universe. I can't get my mind around that. I can't understand that. It's too big for my mind. But God made it all. Hallelujah. And He is a, listen to this. The Bible says, not only did He make the stars, He named them. And He knows every one of them. He's got a count of them. God knows all about it. I'm telling you, God knows all things. Praise God. You can't teach God anything new. He's well aware of all the truths concerning every discipline of study in all of these areas and more. God cannot be taught anything new. God's knowledge encompasses all tenses of time, so that God knows the past, the present, and the future. God knows the past. He doesn't forget the events of the past. He has a perfect memory. God has a perfect memory. You know, concerning the new covenant, Jeremiah 31 and 34, He said, I will remember their sin no more. Now, it isn't because God couldn't remember our sins. It's that God chooses not to call our sins to mind in order to hold them against us. God has a perfect memory. God never forgets anything in the sense that it's wiped out of His mind. But God does not hold against us our sins when we have repented of them and called upon the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. God has knowledge of the present. The Bible says in Hebrews 3 and 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in His sight, but all things are naked and opened unto the eyes of Him with whom we have to do. God is fully aware of this assembly right here. He's fully aware of everybody sitting on these pews. He's fully aware of every detail in all of the universe. God is acquainted perfectly with the present and everything going on at this present moment in all of the universe. God, the Bible says in Proverbs 15 and 3, the eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding the evil and the good. God not only knows the past and the present, He also understands the future. The Bible said in Isaiah 42:89, I am the Lord. That is my name. And my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. God makes this foreknowledge a test of deity. He said in Isaiah 41 and verse 23, show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know that you are gods. Yea, do good or do evil, that we may be dismayed and behold it together. In other words, God says, the idols that you worship, let them tell you the future. Let them tell you what's going to happen beyond the moment. He makes this a test of deity. God is the only one that perfectly knows the future. We call that the foreknowledge of God. Now, in the scriptures, there are some things that are not easily understood. And I knew that when I tackled this. I knew that. And there's some things about the foreknowledge of God, and there's some things about God's perfect knowledge that I don't completely understand. You can read scriptures like Genesis 18, 20 and 21, when the three angels came down to Abraham's house, and the Lord was one of those angels. It was the pre-incarnate appearance of Jesus Christ, and He is one of the angels that comes by Abraham's house. And he told Abraham what he was going to do. Genesis 18, 20 and 21. The Lord said, because the cry of Sodom and Gomorrah is great, and because their sin is very grievous, I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it which has come unto me, and if not, I will know. And it seems to indicate that there was something about the present situation in Sodom that he did not know. Well, I don't know that I can explain that completely to your satisfaction, but I think I might can understand it to my satisfaction. That there are some things, not that God is his knowledge, his mind is ignorant of, but there are some things that God comes to experience for himself. For example, when Jesus came into the world, was incarnate and come into the world, and suffered and persecution and suffered poverty, when he wrote, sent a message to the church at Smyrna, this suffering church, he said to them, listen to this message he sent to them. He said, I know your tribulation, and I know your poverty. He didn't say, I know about it. He said, I know your tribulation. I know your poverty. I have walked in your shoes. I've traveled your path. I've experienced what you're experiencing. So there are some times that God, it's not that God is ignorant of some things. It is that God experiences some things. Now, let's just think with me just a minute. We know that the Lord, of those three angels, the Lord stayed behind to talk to Abraham. The other two angels went on down to Sodom. They approached Lot, wound up staying with Lot that night. What happened to that third man? Well, he told Abraham, he said, I'm going down now. He expressed his intentions to Abraham. He was going down to Sodom. He said, after Abraham got through praying to the Lord, asking him to spare Sodom if he could find so many righteous people, he said in verse 33 of Genesis 18, the Lord went his way. Well, when you read chapter 19 in verse 1, it talks about two angels coming to the house of Lot. We don't see this third man anymore. But he told Abraham he was going down to Sodom. So, even though we don't see him, he is there in Sodom. I'm telling you, while the two angels are informing Lot of God's plans to destroy Sodom, that third man is somewhere in Sodom that night. While those two angels are trying to persuade Lot to leave, get his family and leave, that third man is in Sodom that night. When the men of Sodom gather around the house of Lot and they're riding around the house that night, standing somewhere in the shadows, there is a heavenly witness on earth to what's going on in Sodom. And he has in his hands fire and brimstone. And he's seeing and hearing and looking on from an earthly perspective, seeing what's happening in the city of Sodom. Angels impose a temporary judgment on the men of Sodom by causing blindness to come upon them. But this third man has the fire and brimstone in his hands. And he imposes an eternal judgment upon them. As the Bible says, God caused Sodom to be burnt with everlasting fire. I'm telling you, the judgment that they saw with their eyes, that Abraham saw with his eyes, as Sodom was burned with fire and brimstone, that was only the earthly part of it. They suffered the vengeance of eternal fire. They're still in the fire this very night. That third man, standing in the shadows, unseen, he had the fire and the brimstone in his hands. For purposes known and unknown, God chooses to experience sometimes what he already knows in his mind. And so, I think in my mind, that satisfies my understanding of that passage of Scripture. Then fourth, I want you to know that God's knowledge is minute and personal. I want you to understand this. God's knowledge is minute and personal. Listen to this. He knows your heart. Oh, yeah. The Bible said in Jeremiah 17 and 10, I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins. He knows not only what we do, He knows why we do it. He knows what motivates my life. He knows what motivates your life. You know, you can do the right thing for the wrong reasons. Do you know that? There are some people that give alms and sound trumpets. They do the right thing, but they do it for the wrong reasons. And God knows not only what you are doing, He knows your heart. He knows the reason why you're doing it. God searches the heart. He searches the motives of our heart. God knows why we do it. Do we do it because we love Him? Or do we do it because we love the applause of men? God understands why we do what we do. He knows your heart. Listen to this. He knows your thoughts. Oh my. God knows your thoughts. Brother Michael, we're going to have some help back there. Or I'm going to lose this whole crowd. I've got to have some air. Or we're going to lose this whole crowd here. We're putting them all to sleep. It's too hot. Amen. Psalm 139. If you turn in your Bible to Psalm 139. This is a marvelous scripture about God's knowledge, minute knowledge of us. Look at this. Psalm 139, verse 1. O Lord, Thou hast searched me and known me. Thou knowest my down-sitting, mine uprising. God saw you when you sat down. He saw you when you got up. Thou understandest my thought afar off. God not only knows what you're doing, He knows what you're thinking. I'm telling you, that's the reason why we have to guard our thoughts. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. God knows not only what you're doing, God knows what you're thinking. Thou compassest my path and my lying down and art acquainted with all of my ways. God knows the habits of your life. He knows what you do every morning. He knows the things that you habitually do in your life. God understands completely your ways. There's not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, Thou knowest it altogether. Thou hast beset me behind, before, laid Thine hand upon me. Listen to what the psalmist said. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It's too high. I cannot attain unto it. That God could keep track of such minute details of my life and your life. God understands us completely. Now, that's not all. Listen to this. God keeps account of every hair on your head. The Bible said in Matthew 10 and 30, but the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So that God keeps a daily count, an hourly count, a minute-by-minute count of how many hairs are on your head. And it's changing constantly with me. And God knows all about you. And you know, for some of you, that might be comforting. For others of you, that might be terrifying. And it ought to be. But I'm telling you, God is minutely acquainted with your ways, your thoughts, your words. You're everything. That God knows all about you. This is the basis of His judgment of us. This is what qualifies God for judgment. Listen to this. Ecclesiastes 12 and 14. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. This scripture lets us know that God has a perfect memory. And those things, you know, sometimes here's what we think, folks. We think that if we reform our lives, if we quit doing some of the wicked things that we've done, that we'll get by the judgment of God. But you're not going to get by just because you quit doing certain things. There's going to be a day of reckoning. There's going to be a time you're going to face those charges. There's going to be a time when it's going to be brought up in the judgment of God. God is a perfect memory of the past. And whatever you've done against Him, it will never be wiped off of your record until you repent of it, confess it, and get it under the blood of Jesus. When it says that God forgets our sins, it merely means that God wipes them off the record. Hallelujah. He takes it off the record in heaven so that those sins are not remembered against us. But God has a perfect memory so that when we do not repent, we do not call on the Lord for forgiveness of sins, God will bring everything into judgment, every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. The Bible says in Luke 12:3, therefore whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light. And that which ye have spoken in the ear, in closets, shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. David thought that he had his sin covered up until God spoke to Nathan and told him about it. And Nathan went over there and gave him that parable. And David said, "Well, that man ought to die." And Nathan said, "You are the man." Brother, I'm telling you, God let David know that he knew that ahead of time so that David could get that taken care of. And I'm telling you this morning, are y'all hearing me now? I'm telling y'all this morning, ahead of time, that God knows you. I'm telling you, He knows you perfectly. And you can get your sins taken care of ahead of time this morning if you'll hear this preacher, because every secret thing in your life is going to come out at the judgment if you don't get it under the blood of Jesus Christ. God remembers perfectly. This is the basis of His judgment. He makes no mistakes. God's knowledge is not erroneous. He does not remember faultly. God's memory is perfect. But to those believers, it is a comfort to know that God knows all things. The Bible says in Luke 12:6, are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 farthings, and not one of them is forgotten before God? And did you know that the Bible says you are of much more value than many sparrows? That not one sparrow is forgotten before God, and you are of much more value than many sparrows. God thinks upon you as a child of God, as a believer. Hebrews 6:10 says, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which you have showed toward His name, in that you have ministered to the saints and do minister. Now get this. Sometimes you are worn out in your service for God. Sometimes you feel like that you are pushed to the limit. But God says, I will not forget your labor of love. I will not forget your ministry to the servants of God. God does not forget. Hear me. He knows perfectly, not only when people do wrong, but God knows perfectly when you're fulfilling service for Him. He sees it and never forgets it. The Bible tells us about Hagar, the maidservant of Sarah. After Abraham, if she's conceived by Abraham, and Sarah treats her harshly, and she's fleeing from Sarah. She's an expectant woman, and she's fleeing from her master, mistress. And an angel finds her by a well of water, told her to go back home to her mistress. Gave her the name of her child. Said, I want you to call him Ishmael. And gave her promises concerning this child. Said, he's going to be the father of a multitude of people. After the angel got through talking to her, she recognized it was the Lord. And she called his name, Thou God seest me. Praise God. a hurting woman, a fleeing woman, a lonely woman, a woman whose life was in danger, an expectant woman in the wilderness. And she said, "Thou, God, seest me." Sometimes we wonder, does he know where I'm at? Does he know what I'm going through? Can he see my tears? Can he hear my cry? Does he know? This is his name. Thou, God, seest me. He knows where you're at. He knows what you're going through. God sees you, knows you perfectly. Thou, God, seest me. Let's stand together.